Hi, everyone, to the American Foreign Service Association. My name is Ian Houston. I'm the executive director here, and it's a pleasure to have you here today. And we appreciate having these sorts of talks and discussions. It's a really great use of AFSA and trying to draw attention to some very key vital issues, and we're grateful to have Daryl Copeland with us today. Daryl is a former Canadian Foreign Service officer and someone who writes provocatively and thinks, if one can think provocatively, I think that is hopefully what we all can do, about some key topics that are of interest to our membership and to the Foreign Service. Ambassador Barbara Stevenson, who's the AFSA president, often refers to the new threat set and often credits Daryl for the formulation of this interesting idea. And it really has been a part of her vision for the future of the United States Foreign Service. Today, the central challenge for traditional governing institutions is the multitude of actors. Power is now so diffuse that there is a real risk of the noise simply overwhelming the ability to take effective and collective action. We are now in a new global operating environment where stakeholder engagement and social license have become absolutely central to closing the governance gap. Having approval from a handful of elites in business and government is no longer enough. We need a wide range of partners to craft a way forward that is accepted as fair. And this is especially important because the challenges of the future are vastly different from past ones. How we prepare for them, understand them, and work to solve them cannot and will not be modeled on past practice. And so Daryl understands this and has been doing a lot of thinking in this area. He has expounded on it beautifully, I would say, in his writing and in his eloquent speaking. And that's why we are excited to have him here at AFSA today and to continue that conversation of how the Foreign Service is best suited to deal with these new challenges. And before I welcome Daryl officially to the podium, let me just impress you a little bit with his background and his bio. First of all, I would say he got on a plane this morning to come here today from Quebec and is leaving tonight to go back because he's so busy. He has so much going on. And that's a real credit to him to fly this morning here to Washington, do this event with us, and then to go back to the work that he has happening. He's a senior fellow at the Canadian Global Affairs Institute and Policy Fellow at the University of Montreal's Central for International Studies and Research. He's also an analyst, author, consultant, educator, specializing in science and technology, diplomacy, international policy, global issues, and public management. He's also a world traveler, and Daryl was just telling me an interesting story about his travels recently to Greece. From 1981 to 2011, he served as a Canadian diplomat with postings in Thailand, Ethiopia, New Zealand, and Malaysia. And he teaches an advanced seminar on science, technology, diplomacy, and international policy at universities and training institutes around the world. And so we're just pleased to have Daryl with us today. Before I turn over the podium to Daryl, I would just say we have another event that we're doing a little bit later today that starts at 4 o'clock. So when Daryl is finished at 3:30, we would ask the conversations to maybe happen out in the foyer here because we have to transform this room fairly quickly for this event we have happening, but want to be sensitive to you wanting to talk to Daryl some more. And so with that, I'm very, very pleased to welcome my friend and colleague Daryl Copeland to the podium. Thank you, Daryl.
Hello, everyone. Delighted to be with you today, back again at AFSA. I was here, I guess, in 2010 when I was touring the guerrilla diplomacy book that I did. And I want to talk to you today about science diplomacy and why I've been led to try and drill down somewhat into a better understanding of its importance in the overall scheme of things, given the nature of the challenges that diplomatic practitioners are facing in the 21st century. But let me just say that I came to science and technology as a component of diplomacy and international policy via a very circuitous route. I had almost done 30 years in the Foreign Service without really thinking much about science and technology per se. And when I was out prospecting for support for the book project, I went to visit the International Development Research Center in Ottawa and was sent to see the director of the Science and Policy Division. And he said, you know, Daryl, I think that science and technology is very important and very understudied in international relations and diplomatic studies. And if you could see clear to doing a chapter or two in your book on the role of science and technology, I think we could find a way to support your book project. And I had to go away and think about that for a while, because really I'd never reflected on it at all previously. So I did that, decided that, I did a bit of reading, decided that I would take it on. And one of the real revelations for me in the aftermath has been that of all the content in, you know, about 300 pages of guerrilla diplomacy, it's been the S&T stuff that seems to have really gained the most traction. And I developed a course, and that's what I've been spending my time teaching. So I'd like to talk about that today, and I'd start with a quotation from one of my favorite science diplomats, Albert Einstein. He said, "We can't solve the problems we've created with the same thinking we used in creating them." By way of an illustration, Einstein was teaching at Humboldt University in Berlin in the early 20s, and one of his students failed, had to drop out and repeat the course the following year. It was exam time in year two. These were the days when the professors invigilated the exams and the papers were face down on the desk and sharpened pencils and a clock. At the appointed time, the students were told to begin. They'd turn over the paper, they'd start reading through the questions and figuring out how much time they could devote to each one. And the student who had failed the year before raised his hand and was desperately trying to get Einstein's attention. And the professor looked at him with penetrating gaze and said, yes. And the student stood up and said, well, professor, I think that there's a problem here. And the professor said, what do you think the problem is? And the student said, well, as you know, I took this exam last year, and I'm pretty sure that these are the same questions as were on the exam that you gave us last year, so maybe you've handed out the wrong sheets. And Einstein paused, and he looked at him, and he said, of course it's the same questions. It's the answers that have changed. Now, I table that at the beginning of this talk because it strikes me that diplomacy and international policy, in terms of what it's for, what are the ends of these activities, it's always been about finding a way to peace and prosperity, security and development. I think that during much of the 20th century, and certainly through the Cold War, it was widely believed that the best way forward was through defense. What I'm going to argue today is that in the same sense that the question's the same, how do we get to security and development, peace and prosperity, the answer that's changed is that it's no longer through defense or through the use of armed force. Rather, it's through diplomacy, and given the nature of the challenges that we're facing, it strikes me that science diplomacy is going to play a particular role. To get into that kind of meta-analysis, why science diplomacy, given the nature of the operating environment that diplomats are facing in the 21st century, I've been thinking hard about how to just crunch it into a manageable number of kind of idea clusters, and I'm going to test fly them on you today. This doesn't even appear in any of my writing yet. But the five features which I think define this transformed operating environment for diplomacy in the 21st century, and that have created these special opportunities for science diplomacy, are, and I'm going to elaborate a bit on each, the march of globalization, the emerging heteropolis, shifting power, the emerging security/development nexus, and the ascendance of this new threat set of issues that are rooted in science and driven by technology. Let me just expand on each of those for a moment. Globalization, it's one of those words gets thrown around a lot without people, I think, really pausing to contemplate what the implications of a globalizing world are. It strikes me that they're both totalizing and highly paradoxical, because globalization is compressing space, it's accelerating time, it's deterritorializing our politics, it's integrating culturally even as it fragments politically, it connects even as it differentiates, it creates wealth but not for all. It polarizes, it increases inequality, it socializes costs and privatizes benefits. It is, if nothing else, volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous in its effects. But one of its hallmarks, the revolution in information and communication technologies, has enormously facilitated collaboration across borders, and hence, and here's the connection to science and technology, expedited the internationalization of scientific activity. And if you look at science and you look at the profile of scientific research and R&D generally, you will find that it is increasingly less national and more international. So point one, the march of globalization, an opening for science diplomacy. The rising heteropolis. James Derderian, a friend of mine who now is teaching at the University of Sydney, but prior to that was at Brown, coined the term heteropolarity back in the early years of the last decade. He didn't develop it much. I really liked the word, and I liked it in contrast to multipolarity. And here's why. At the end of the Cold War, it was widely assumed that the world was reverting after the brief period of unipolarity or American hegemony or however you would like to describe it between the end of the Cold War and, say, the invasion of Iraq or so. People thought we were returning to some kind of multipolar dispensation. And that struck me as wrong. It struck me as wrong because the idea of multipolarity comes from really 19th century European thinking and European political developments. The Congress of Vienna, the Concert of Europe, etc., had a lot to do with attempts to balance power in the days when the sources and vectors of everybody's power were more or less similar, and everybody knew each other. So the great statesmen, the Maeterlincks, the Castlereaghs, the Talleyrands, the Bismarcks, they'd sit around the green felt tables, and although the hands that they were holding were slightly different, the cards all came from the same deck. The difference today is that there's all kinds of different decks that people are playing from. Nobody's sitting around the same tables, and they certainly don't really know each other. So when we talk about heteropolarity or the rising heteropolis or a heteropolitan world order in the making, we're talking about a place where the vectors and drivers of power and influence are characterized more by difference than by similarity. It used to be, as I said, the hands that they'd hold, they were different, but they came from the same deck. So it was, you know, how big is your empire? How much artillery do you have? How large is your navy? What's the size of your population? How big is your economy? It was easy to compare and hence to try and balance that kind of power. And that sort of balance of power thinking worked all the way through two world wars and even into the Cold War, when the calculus of balancing power was mutually assured destruction. Merved missiles and mobility of warheads and so on, but it was still, the sources and the vectors of the power were roughly similar, so you could at least have a try at balancing them. In this emerging heteropolis, that's going to be much more difficult, partly because many of the poles that are emerging aren't states. They're corporations or groups of states or even individuals. I think you could argue that Bill Gates is kind of a pole, Andrew Soros, Bono. You could certainly argue that ASEAN is emerging as a pole. You've got the individual BRICS and the BRICS collectively. I mean, it is a very messy, extremely complicated, and very cross-cut new order that's coming up there, and I don't think multipolarity thinking is really up to describing it. So the thing about this new order, you know, among the challenges, not to mention how do you try and manage the common spaces between all of these highly differentiated poles, China, the world's manufacturer, Russia, some sort of a petropole, Brazil trying to be the voice of the global south even as it's imploding, and an agro-industrial superpower. I mean, it is the European Union, for all of its troubles, just gushing with soft power, with history and art and culture. I mean, it's got its own comparative advantage, but these are all very different. The U.S., strong in a whole bunch of suits, but if nothing else, the world's praetorian pole, the overwhelmingly strong military power. I will argue that that's not necessarily the best measurement of your actual power and influence over outcomes in the world of the 21st century, but there's no doubting that America is far and away the world's strongest military power and will be for the foreseeable future, probably long after people are claiming that China and maybe India have overtaken it as an economic power, although I think that's I think one wants to be very careful with what sort of benchmarks you're using there, too. So, rising heteropolis. Three, shifting power. Well, everybody hears a lot about how power is moving inexorably from the North Atlantic to the Asia Pacific and the dynamic center of the global economies moving in that direction. And, I think that there's quite a bit of evidence that supports paying a lot of attention to that trend line. But I think power is shifting in other ways and that are possibly more important. And mainly, power is shifting out of states. Now, this is something Anne-Marie Slaughter likes to talk about a lot, but the end of state centricity is terribly important if you're interested in diplomacy. Because power is moving up to supranational institutions, it's moving out to other actors, can be NGOs, can be universities, can be think tanks, can be transnational corporations, and it's moving downwards to other levels of government. Provinces, in the case of Canada, our province of Quebec has a network of 20 of its own diplomatic missions around the world, states. And I think the really interesting and probably want to keep your eye on the ball measure of the downward movement of power is to cities. I think cities are emerging in the 21st century as a terribly important unit of international political accounting, and that hasn't been broadly recognized. So power is shifting, and what this means is that traditional diplomatic methods and tools really need to be supplemented by less conventional, more innovative approaches to diplomatic practice, such as, I think, science diplomacy. So just as in a heteropolar world order, where vectors of power and influence are characterized more by difference than similarity, armed force is going to have a limited role to play. diplomacy is going to have a large role to play. In the case of shifting power, even if diplomacy is center stage, our diplomacy is going to have to be tuned up very significantly if we're going to perform and produce the results that are going to be required. My fourth point is that the more I've thought about security and development, the more I've thought that it's very difficult to make a distinction between the two. In this age of globalization, disappearing borders, the end of state centricity, and all of this stuff, security, it strikes me, is no longer a martial art, or at least it's no longer just a martial art. And development is no longer something that is imperative only in the global south, the way we used to think of it. Security and development, it strikes me, have really become indivisible. They've become two sides of the same coin, joined at the hip. With the welfare of the human person as the central referent, I think that's really the key. So security, I think people feel secure when they have an absence of want, an absence of fear, and their basic needs are met. I think that people are experiencing development when they find themselves in an environment, political, cultural, or social, or economic, or all of those, where they can approach something like their potential without running into undue obstacles or constraints. So you can see, if you conceive of security and development in those terms, they become really very, very close. So I would call that the emerging security and development nexus. And by way of illustrating the centrality of science, technology, and I suppose innovation as well to security and development, I would just note that science diplomacy is going to be absolutely key to the achievement of all 17 of the recently internationally accepted sustainable development goals. My final point, and from which we get the title of the remarks today about the ascendance of the new threat set, here the idea is, folks, that it's no longer ideological rivalry or territorial ambition, as was the case in the Cold War. It's not terrorism or religious extremism or political violence, which was met with the response of the Global War on Terror or whatever it's called these days, but rather, it seems to me that the more profound threats which imperil the future of the planet have something in common, and that is that they are wicked transnational issues that are rooted in science and driven by technology. And among these issues are climate change, diminishing biodiversity, species extinction, food and water insecurity, environmental collapse, genomics, the challenge of how do we manage the global commons, weapons of mass destruction. I mean, these are challenges or threats, if you want to put it in those terms, that imperil us all. Unlike religious extremism and political violence, and I'm not saying that they're not problems, I'm saying they don't make my A-list. And I think that there's some important implications there. But in fact, these these issues that constitute the new threat set, if you're looking for a cute little acronym to describe them, I think you could say a wicked issue, which is one of these new threats, is one which cuts all ways, C-U-T-S, capitalize the acronym, C for cross-cutting, U for unresolved, T for transnational, and S for science-based. So a wicked issue is one which cuts all ways, and of course, climate change, the classic, energy, environment, economy, just completely cross-cutting with very significant security implications. Some of the implications, well, I think that we all need a world view, a W-O-R-L-D view, but we also need a world view, a W-H-I-R-L-E-D view, because one of the things that globalization has done is it's put a lot of the old distinctions in a blender. And everything is just whirling, whirling, whirling around, and it's extremely difficult, I find anyway, to find a new way to conceptualize and situate this this uncharted new territory that we're entering. But I think there are some conclusions that we can nonetheless reach. One is that the military is both too sharp and too dull an instrument to treat the challenges of globalization. Yet the militaries everywhere, continue to attract the lion's share of resources. And because they get the lion's share of resources, they get the lion's share of taskings. They tend to do a lot of things that you wouldn't normally expect militaries to do. So the U.S. military led the U.S. assistance mission, for example, in the wake of the Haitian earthquake. Many other examples like that. And you might ask yourself, well, why was it the military? Well, it was the military because, you know, they had the capacity. But is that what militaries are designed for? Because you can do something, I don't think necessarily means that you should. And I argue that specialty built to purpose civilian agencies would in many instances do a lot of things that militaries are being used for more efficiently and more effectively, but as a matter of fact, don't get it because they don't get the resources that they need. And I happen to think that diplomats are among those sort of civil society actors that are significantly under-resourced, and I think Secretary Gates would agree with me on that. So it strikes me that this imbalance, by the way, in terms of resource distribution, actually should be a major political and public policy issue. And the fact that it's not is one of the reasons that I spend so much time on the road. So how do we do, then, a better job on advancing these big files of peace and prosperity, security and development in the 21st century? And in particular, how can we do a better job in the 21st century than we did in the 20th? Because we did a pretty bad job in the 20th of accommodating shifting power, didn't we? I mean, it cost us two world wars and a cold war. I mean, I don't think that this is something to celebrate. And it strikes me that because science diplomacy is uniquely suited to treat this new threat set, because science diplomacy uses knowledge-based, technologically enabled problem solving to tackle these wicked issues, it strikes me that there's a very good match here between this combination of science and diplomacy, the science being the knowledge-based problem solving, the evidence-based policy development, and the diplomacy being the non-violent approach to managing international relations characterized by dialogue, negotiation, compromise, plus the knowledge-based problem solving and a bit of complex balancing in there. So you put the two together, you take the political agency and the non-violence and the communications-centric nature of diplomacy, and you combine that with the knowledge-driven aspects of science, put them together in science diplomacy, and you've got at least a chance, I think, a fighting chance of dealing with the new threat set. I'd expected to see my good friend Von Turekian here today. I do see him. Hi, Von. Von did some really pioneering work in this area, and if any of you don't know him, he is the science and technology advisor to the State Department and to Secretary Kerry, and prior to that ran the science and diplomacy program at the AAAS. Back in 2010, Vaughan and some folks from the Royal Society, and I think with some help from Kristen Lord, put together a very useful tripartite model for science diplomacy to help us really get a clearer sense of what the constituent elements are. And they speak there in terms of science in diplomacy, so that's injecting scientific knowledge and analysis into the policy and decision-making process. So that's what Vaughan does at the State Department. That's what Robin Grimes does for the Foreign Office in the UK. That's what Peter Gluckman does for the New Zealand Foreign Ministry and the Prime Minister's office there. So that's science in diplomacy. That's the infusion of scientific expertise into government. Then there's science for diplomacy, and that is where you use international scientific cooperation activity endeavor to advance diplomatic ends. There's many examples of that. Most of the really salient ones, I think, were drawn from the Cold War, when at times the relations between the West and the then Soviet Union were so strained that if it weren't for the continuing scientific lines of communications remaining open, there would have been a real risk of a complete rupture, thus leaving the world much less safe and secure. Even since then, using science cooperation to improve international relations, it kept lines of communication open with North Korea, with Cuba, with Iran, and look at the recent Iran nuclear deal. We've got the very interesting Sesame Synchrotron project running just outside of Amman, Jordan, which brings Israel to the same table as the Palestinian Authority, several Gulf states, Egypt, Saudi, and a number of others. I mean, this, in a way, is the diplomatic power of science on display. And there's institutions as well, the International Space Station. I mean, even at the height of the U.S.-Russian acrimony over the annexation of Korea and then the war in the Donbass in eastern Ukraine, Russian missiles were still carrying American astronauts up and down to the space station. And American and Russian scientists were continuing to work on all kinds of Arctic research, deep seabed research, atmospheric research. So even when lines of communication, traditional diplomatic communications, are strained or blocked or even non-existent, science can play a really useful role in keeping some lines of communications open. So that's the science for diplomacy. And diplomacy for science, without sounding too pedantic, that's about facilitating international science cooperation through diplomacy. So that's where the diplomats get together and try and advance scientific objectives. So the Kyoto process and the Committee of the Parties, the COP negotiations, various environmental and arms control treaties fall into that. The nuclear deal with Iran from last year, the wonderful achievement of decommissioning the Syrian chemical weapons program 2 years ago. That's all. Those are all very good examples of science for diplomacy. Just a couple of caveats on the science diplomacy thing. And I'd been doing diplomacy for so long, and I don't think I'd ever even come across the words science and diplomacy, these two nouns, in such close proximity. But I just want to say that it's not to be confused with international cooperation, international scientific cooperation. That happens all the time between universities, in the private sector. Pharmaceutical companies could be doing joint research to produce a better cold medicine or a more effective wrinkle cream or whatever. I mean, that's international scientific cooperation, but it's not science diplomacy. The difference, of course, is that the diplomacy part means it's got a connection to states or international organizations or government. So international science cooperation and science diplomacy are not one and the same. Sometimes science diplomacy involves international scientific cooperation, but often international scientific cooperation is without diplomatic content. Secondly, science diplomacy is not always on the side of the angels, though we might wish it to be so. Certainly A.Q. Khan's successful efforts to bring nuclear weapons to Pakistan through covert collaboration with North Korea, Libya, and China. I mean, that was science diplomacy as well, but it's not the type of science diplomacy that we would wish to use to treat these wicked issues that I referred to. It can be a tremendous generator of soft power, science diplomacy. It's a great way to put on display national prowess. Ironically, however, science diplomacy was much more evident and on display during the Cold War than it is today. And I think that's got to change. I mentioned what I think its comparative advantage is vis-a-vis other international policy instruments, which is to say that it's ideally suited in this emerging heteropolis and age of globalization to help treat these wicked issues. But I also think that science, the idea of science, can really serve as a beacon, a guiding and a unifying source to help illuminate a common way forward. There's something very attractive about the idea of science. If you've ever reflected on it much, it can be, I mentioned its important role in security and development, but in terms of democracy, good governance, responsible public administration, it really encourages all of those things in a society because of its connection to openness, and that's the idea that scientific research is preponderantly public rather than private. Merit, and that's the peer review aspect. Civic values, and notably the accommodation of dissent and difference, and that is that scientific research is often highly contested. And accountability, because the people that do the research and publish the research put their names on it. So these are all, I believe, very useful values when we think about governance and public administration. So science and technology, I mean, it's an essential tool for connecting the policy-making process to knowledge-based, technologically-enabled solutions, but it also helps to forge shared interests, and that's terribly important. It fosters solidarity. It encourages cooperation and action in concert. The first S&T advisor, I guess to Madeleine Albright, Norm Neureiter, who is a good friend of Vaughn's, often likes to say that policy without science is gambling. And I think he's right. I really believe that science is a cornerstone of human process, of human progress, and terribly important both as a process and as an outcome in terms of getting from where we are to where we want to be. But, and here's the but, and here's the rub, although the business case for science diplomacy and science and technology more generally is strong, when we look around, we see that S&T capacity is largely alien to and almost invisible within most institutions of global governance. Foreign ministries, development agencies, multilateral organizations, they're typically without the scientific expertise or without enough scientific expertise, technological savvy, cultural predisposition, R&D network access required to bridge digital divides and manage these wicked S&T-driven issues very effectively. And although research and development, I would say, and innovation tend to thrive in lateral, interconnected, and networked settings, if you look in most foreign ministries and international organizations, that's not what you see. Instead, you tend to see bureaucratic sclerosis, rigid occupational hierarchies, and rather authoritarian social relations, and science does not thrive, and innovation does not thrive in that kind of environment. Moreover, these shortcomings and capacity gaps, these challenges that science diplomacy is facing, I think have been exacerbated by three even larger challenges. One is that science and tech itself is a bit of a two-edged sword. As I said, science diplomacy is not always on the side of the angels. Well, science and technology, although it can be a crucial contributor to security and development, as I've argued, it can also drive insecurity and underdevelopment. Let's face it, it can cause suffering and abet exploitation. It can advance the dark horses of war and devastation and destruction. So S&T is a two-edged sword and requires very careful management. Secondly, science and diplomacy in combination are pretty much enough to stop any dinner party conversation in its footsteps. Science is often recalled as something complex and impenetrable that people just wanted to drop in high school. They remember having to memorize the periodic table or figure out what the endoplasmic reticulum was or something like that. And, you know, science, an awful lot of people in foreign ministries and foreign services, that was something that they just wanted to leave behind so they could get on with studying history or politics or whatever. Similarly, diplomacy, I think it's widely seen as esoteric, wasteful, ineffective. It's associated with pinstripes and pearls, with Chamberlain in Munich, with weakness and appeasement, with caving into power. It's seen as an anachronistic practice, and diplomats as as kind of pathetic figures, hopelessly lost in a haze of obsolescence somewhere between protocol and alcohol. I think diplomacy and diplomats definitely have an image problem. Third thing is that the worlds of science and technology and diplomacy and international policy rarely intersect. You must ask yourself, how many scientists are diplomats? How many diplomats are scientists? How often do scientists and diplomats get together and talk? When they try and talk, do they speak the same language? Can they communicate? Often not. I mean, scientists are notoriously bad communicators, and diplomats are notorious for their unwillingness to deal with non-traditional issues. And many of these S&T wicked issues are nothing if not unconventional. So scientists and diplomats make very strange bedfellows. They have a lot of trouble communicating. And I think one of the reasons is that their culture and values are profoundly divergent. And I was thinking about this when I was doing my teaching in Vienna in April, and kind of assigned it to my class for one day to come up with some of these fundamental kind of differences in culture and values. And here's the list that we came up with. Diplomacy about stability and balancing power. Science about change and unleashing power. Diplomacy about convention and conventions, like the Vienna Conventions and the conventional, conventional ways of behaving. Science about experimentation. Diplomacy about risk aversion. Science about risk tolerance. Diplomacy about practice and things practical. Science about theory and things theoretical. Diplomacy about argument. Tact, discretion, persuasion, influence, science about facts and data. Diplomacy about negotiation and compromise, science about trial and error. Diplomacy about the world of the political, science about the world of the empirical. Diplomacy about the polis, science about the lab. These are pretty profound distinctions, I would suggest. So for these reasons and more, scientists and diplomats are rarely seen to be getting along. But if we're going to get from where we are to where we need to be, I argue they need to spend more time together, maybe try some counseling. What are the prospects for the fix? Unfortunately, even the best science diplomacy practices are the exception rather than the rule. Among best practices, examples that I often give, are the US, the UK, the Swiss, the Spanish, the Japanese, and the Kiwis. Given the audience, let me just say that whatever criticisms one might bring to bear on American diplomacy, when it comes to the infusion of scientific expertise throughout the decision-making chain, and it doesn't mean that advice is always taken, but in terms of making it available, it stands pretty much head and shoulders above anyone else. That plus the fact that the AAAS have a fellowship program that brings high-level expertise directly into the State Department. There's the Jefferson Fellows Program that brings expertise directly in. There's the nomination of presidential envoys to do science diplomacy explicitly. There's the fact that Vaughan has his job. In my 30 years as a Canadian diplomat, we never had a science advisor in our foreign ministry, and indeed our conservative government, now happily departed, fired the science advisor to our central agencies because they were kind of science deniers. So I could go on and cite some best cases, but my real message is that don't think that the exceptions prove the rule, because by and large, we really are globally behind the eight ball on the science diplomacy file. And I've got a lot of suggestions for how we can bridge the performance gap. I see we're running a bit short on time, and honestly, I don't like to drone on like I've been doing. I prefer a much more interactive and Socratic exchange. So I'm going to bring my remarks to a close, but let me just leave you with a couple of thoughts. I hope that you might find these images are useful. If you think of science and technology and diplomacy and international policy as floating worlds that somehow must be brought together, think of them coming together and creating a Venn diagram, and where those bubbles, where those spheres intersect, that's the sweet spot where science diplomacy should be taking place. I think that radical reform of our institutions, whether they're foreign ministries or international organizations, to increase science capacity is terribly important. And I think that we need to develop a new narrative for diplomacy generally and for science diplomacy in particular. Recently, with all of the emphasis on digital diplomacy, you've undoubtedly heard about twiplomacy. So do we need a skiplomacy or a skyplomacy? I don't know. It's a thought. So just by way of wrapping, there is a dialectic result, relationship between results and resources. And I think short of demilitarizing international policy, reinvesting in diplomacy and science diplomacy and diplomatic capacity more generally, that these really are the sine qua non for getting to a higher state of preparedness to treat the new threat set. It's long past time, in my view, that governments and international organizations reconsidered their priorities and reallocated their resources accordingly. So I began with Einstein. Let me conclude with Einstein. He said, "Learn from yesterday, live for today, hope for tomorrow. The important thing is to not stop questioning." So thank you for listening. I skipped over some large bits, but I think it's probably better to go to discussion now, and I'm happy to take questions, comments, criticisms. And if you wouldn't mind just telling me who you are, because that will help me. I'm delighted that you're at the World Bank and thinking about that kind of thing, because clearly imposing solutions on perceived problems can cause a lot of anger and resentment and blowback, which is the last thing we want. I think one of the keys to doing science diplomacy effectively is to ensure that the people that are doing it have some of the key diplomatic credentials in terms of a knowledge of and a connection to place. That's the whole reason that we have missions abroad and people who've got language skills and have taken the time to learn something about the culture and the history of the places that they're active in. So I would, you know, we have so many examples of failed aid projects where these very basic considerations have not been put front and center. But you're absolutely right. If science diplomacy is going to work, there's going to be a major cross-cultural education component to it, because otherwise it'll never stick, and it'll could even be counterproductive. So, but that, you know, we could have a very long conversation about that. But a very good point. Yes.
In the economic, has there been any thought given to the direct application of scientific solutions to diplomatic problems? And by way of of examples or illustrations, and these aren't thought out at all. These are just thrown out as an example. Something like two entities, maybe Sudan and South Sudan, are fighting over resources. Could there be, in the beginning, a scientific way to come up with more resources to take care of that problem and then use that as a scaffold for further diplomatic work to get to the contextual issues around that basic resource problem?
Yeah, I mean, I think so. I couldn't give you an example that's a very close parallel to the one that you sketched, but that idea that diplomats use their capacity to access something which in my book I call the global political economy of knowledge. And this is the idea of encountering problems on the ground, assessing them, going into the accumulated world of knowledge and understanding, bringing to bear such expertise and specialized capacity as you can bring to bear on a particular problem that you've identified. And once you've achieved buy-in and got some sort of a sense that you might be able to construct a durable solution, then you can start to build on that. So that would be an example within the science for diplomacy part of the triad that I set out. But, you know, examples of success of the type that you, it would be very good to try and put together some case studies, and I haven't done that and can't give you examples. Maybe someone else in the audience could. But you're definitely on the right track. I mean, what you've done, I think, is illustrate the promise of science diplomacy. Yes?
Yes, my name is Steve Ramirez. I'm a public diplomacy officer, but I'm currently doing a domestic assignment in the Foreign Assistance Resources Bureau in the Evaluation Office, which is data-driven. And maybe this is more of a question for actually AFSA itself, but you know, we are defined in the Foreign Service by, to some certain degree, by the specialty that we're in, whether it's public diplomacy or management or econ or you know, political. But we have a few science and technology officers, but they're scattered. And it maybe begs the question, I mean, if you're, what you're positing, and I think it makes a lot of sense, if we're really gonna get to where we need to be in order to be able to address these issues, should AFSA be thinking in terms of creating a cone that is specifically for S&T to give it the weight to be able to argue that without this presence and to build up the capacity and to be able to have the presence with our work instead of being, you know, this sort of, yeah, there's a couple of us, you know, in Brazil or somewhere else. I mean, I know we're, you know, hidebound, hierarchical, risk-averse institution, and this is not the sort of thing that is done lightly, but maybe that's something we need to be, what do you think that would be? I mean, I know you're from Canada, and it's different there, but, you know, do you think that might make sense? And the second issue I wanted to touch on briefly is this issue of where you talked about of the five items of this, the shifting of power. And we see that, you know, in the American polity today, a lot of people are very upset with the elites that you referred to, you know, whether it's the stagnation in a lot of people's incomes, that they don't feel that the system is working, and all the anger and the Trumpism, et cetera. And yet, and then you have George Will in the Today's Washington Post saying that, yes, England should get out of Europe. And the argument is being made that it's, you know, it's this, it's become this Europe that is sclerotic and it's opaque and it's non-representative. And so he's sort of making the argument that it should be, maybe it would be more democratic if they could have their own, you know, return to their own polity. And yet, you know, you look at places like Scotland and you look at Catalonia in Spain, which have been making strong arguments for more local control. And your argument in terms of maybe, you didn't specifically say devolution towards cities, but if we're going to move in the direction where people can more locally take control over their own situations, you know, what's the best path forward to do that?
Look, on the issue of the cone, or in our foreign service, we call them streams.
Daryl, could I just?
Yeah, sure.
Stephanie Kenny, and I'm going to take the liberty of interrupting because what I wanted to say is very much tied to his. And
good.
I think it'll help you in answering. How many people in this room are foreign service officers who have come in since 1995? Okay, so we've got at least three or four. You're looking at the last foreign service officer promoted into the senior service as an environment, science, technology, and health mm-hmm. officer, because there was a
science cone,
and it was unilaterally abolished by a political appointee who neither knew, understood, nor consulted. I don't know where AFSA was. That would be a historical question in and of itself worth pursuing. How that happened. But you would think that in 1995-96, by the way, I was also the only Foreign Service officer involved from start to finish in the negotiation of the Framework Convention on Climate Change. And I'm here to tell you that it is not a scientific problem, it's a political problem. The issues have not changed in 30 years. As they were in 1992, national differences, transfer of technology, money, and responsibility. We have made progress on responsibility, and transfer of technology is certainly a much better understood in terms of its constraints and realities among the developing nations today than it was 30 years ago. But it's not to overstate the science, which I don't think you were trying to do. It is this Venn diagram, but I think your question is extremely important, and it can only be addressed if it comes from within the active duty diplomatic service, the foreign service. If you all don't do it, you don't come to AFSA, you make an issue here, and you don't go up the line, organize yourselves, and say, what is it that there's very little rotation in OES for foreign service officers to go into? There's very little rotation in any of the functional bureaus, arms control, economics, whatever. This is not a domestic issue, as Daryl has very clearly laid out. And if you cannot be multilingual, you have to be able to speak diplomacy and not the lab science, but science, policy, and its economic, political, and security ramifications. And that's a very different lexicon than science. I agree that scientists generally aren't. I thought description of the two cultures was excellent. There's a parallel one for diplomacy and military. And if we do not have people within the Foreign Service who are multilingual, who speak both, it's going to be very difficult. But I'd like to pick up on this question to hear your thoughts very much. And also, maybe you can give us at least a quick hint of the what do we do about it? Is a cone in the case of the U.S. a good idea? Are there other things that can speak not to the myriad technical experts who want to play internationally? That's not diplomacy, but to diplomatic services mm-hmm. as such. And forgive my going on.
No, that was very good, and I like the questions too. Actually, the reconstruction of a science cone within state was one of the bits that I dropped when I just left page three out because we were running out of time. But absolutely, and a specialty within foreign ministries. Better use of the networks of science counselors and science attachés. Even if they're only brought in for short-term assignments, making better use, doing exit interviews, I mean, just doing a much more systematic job of bringing your scientific capacity to bear on the professional challenges that you're facing. The Brits have their Science and Innovation Network, where they, and it does have a node in London, where they put people, there's 100-some-odd of them, in key locations around the world to cover the S&D files, and they report back to a central place in London that then works on bringing the benefit of their analysis to bear on whatever the issues of the day are. So that's, I think, a useful example. The Spanish are making enormous strides. I met at a conference on science diplomacy 10 days ago in London, the Spanish Minister of State for Science and Technology, and she's very keen on this stuff. And they are using their embassies around the world to convene networks of Spanish diaspora scientists. They lost a huge amount of domestic capacity when their economy imploded in the late 2000s and are now trying to take advantage of their Hispanic scientific diaspora to tap it back into Madrid. And they're achieving some quite impressive results there. In fact, last fall, they had a meeting here in Washington that was organized by their embassy that brought in Spanish scientists from across the United States and Canada. So there are lots of institutional and kind of systemic ways in which I think we can up our game, but it's something that requires, I think, more work. But I think a prerequisite to getting on with that and getting the resources required to do it would be to get recognition of the problem. And I just don't see enough of that anywhere. You know, we are so ill-equipped. It's quite scary, really. I mean, you know, I think one of the reasons that things often seem to be spinning out of control is, you know, they are. I mean, we're really perfectly equipped to fight the last war.
For people in diplomatic service, I think, is also something to really think about. I don't like cones myself. I would abolish them tomorrow if I could. Policy and management, you need both, you know, and you have to have your consular experience. But certainly in terms of career development, in terms of promotion, if there are not incentives built in, because these things matter in developing a diplomatic service for the future, then who's going to take the assignments?
To the back.
Chris Estrada with the Office of American Studies at IIT. We've been sort of practicing dabbling in science diplomacy through science education, setting up science corners around the world. We've got a network of maker spaces and fab labs and spark labs and working with the Smithsonian Institution on these kind of developments. But we are getting resistance, not resistance so much as apathy from different, you know, bureaus in terms of funding science diplomacy, science education, science for public diplomacy. And I'm wondering if you have any suggestions or tips to kind of break the barrier and get some
momentum. Well, you remember my comments about science and diplomacy sharing image problems? I mean, they both do, and put them together, it's a terrible double whammy. You know, honestly, just say science diplomacy at the next dinner party if you want to just stop the conversation.
In order of religion and politics.
You know, I guess one of the ways is for people that are on the science side of things is to work on finding ways to communicate the importance of work, the work that's being done, in terms that people can appreciate. I mean, I taught a couple of years ago at Otago University following a gig that I did that Vaughn was at back in 2011 on science diplomacy that resulted in a book. And there, and as far as I know, it's the only outfit of its kind, they have a Center for Science Communications. And they work uniquely on making science intelligible and relevant and meaningful and real to a non-expert audience. And, you know, I'd say probably in terms of sharpening the relevance and the salience of science, finding a way to improve its intelligibility to people that have been weaned on a diet of infotainment is really key, because science, you know, in this world of voodoo economics and bundled derivative and horrendous political extremism, I mean, science, for all of its foibles, it can really come out looking pretty good relative to the alternatives. But it's finding, you know, I said a narrative. We need to find a way to make it to make the soft power of science have more kind of domestic political currency. Yes.
Hi, thank you. Linda Staley. I've worked in this area for about 25 years. We called it International Science Collaboration back in 1990. I want to just say a couple of things. You, first of all, as I've thought about this issue for a long time, I think we're having Vaughn at State is a big plus with his energy and enthusiasm, and hopefully he'll say a few words. But I think that one of the things that, and Vaughn and I have worked on trying to educate people as well as many others over the last many years, but I think one of the biggest things we can do is really focus in on our universities and getting science curriculum. So you have a Center for Science Diplomacy mm-hmm. in across universities that are housed in the International Affairs, you know, I was at the Jackson School of International Studies, so science diplomacy could be a cone or a focus there. Across the country.
It doesn't exist, does it? Do you know of it?
As far as I know, there's science and communications, but I don't know of any science diplomacy. There's science and security centers.
Yeah, yeah.
Science and security. Georgetown has science diplomacy. And okay, so maybe that's one of the few. But I think developing, well, two things. One is doing the research on the history and the value and the best practices. There are many, many stories, and many of us have talked about them over the years. I mean, as you asked, you know, I was just thinking of the multilaterals in the Middle East in the mid-90s on water. You know, clearly a big tension and brought in scientists there. But there are many examples. But I think that what you're doing, Daryl, is so important to get out and write and talk about it and to do the research. But ultimately, we need to get universities or centers of learning to create the next generation of young people that when they come into the State Department really are pressing for science diplomacy, science engagement as a focus area. And that's the way I think that this is gonna change, is if young people coming in say, you know, this is nuts that we're not talking about this.
There's an exquisite disconnect. That's what I was trying to get at when I said that, you know, in so many foreign ministries, international organizations, the leadership kind of cut its teeth during the Cold War, and they really, they don't get a lot of this stuff. It's just, they really are different worlds. I mean, they're used to dealing with international treaty and legal stuff, territorial disputes, conventional conflict, and things like this, and they're comfortable in that area. But as soon as you start talking science and technology, and they're starting to think that it's time to let somebody else deal with that because it's not their job.
There's another rubric that might be helpful in this context. I teach a graduate seminar on sustainability and public policy, And what I have found useful about sustainability, as opposed to the old environment, science, and technology, is that it's all of the above.
Yes.
And you approach the problems and definition and solving through not only knowledge, what you know, we've got a matrix, but it also includes the unintended consequences, which speaks to the point about doing unto with supreme Western confidence, because you're not perhaps taking into consideration what you don't know. And I have found that the sustainability, because it has a security implication,
yes.
It has a multifaceted, it is multifaceted. You can't, it's not a narrow practical thing, which is part of the problem with the science, the 20th century science world we came from. Same thing with our organizational patterns. They come from factory floors. Well, where's manufacturing today? So that may be another concept or term to think about in this context that's helpful to people.
Further questions and comments?
I'm sure. Legal infrastructure as well, speaking of conventions that you did, which also is inherent to the whole sustainability concept, because there is an international legal framework in every single one of these areas that you were speaking to that is global.
Perhaps we could get Dr. Tarekian to make a comment or two on his experience going back into the State Department.
I won't speak long. And Daryl, it's good, great to see you again, to see so many of my colleagues that I know. I think, as you mentioned, I've now been the science technology advisor here at the State Department for about 8 months, and I'm the fifth in the order. And one of there are a few things about the position I think have been very helpful. One is that over the last four, it's been able to reach into the entire department. I think that one of the challenges, and I think building on something Linda said, which I think is really important, I think scientists in a department of state are it's not an obvious connection, and yet as we develop some sort of a critical mass of scientists that are in the building, understanding the culture over time, I hope that we are value added. And I think that's the piece of it. I think, unfortunately, sometimes scientists view themselves as those who are not speaking the scientific language that we speak. And it comes down to language a lot of times. Those that are not speaking the scientific language we're speaking, I can't speak to you anymore. I had a father who was 57 years, a professor at Yale, a geochemist. And I always used to say to him, you know, what class do you not like teaching? And he'd say, the 101s. And yet, if you look at the places where we're going to get so many of our policy leader, it's in the science class 101. And that's where, as scientists, we've got to be able to engage much more actively. Actually, over time, that changed. He saw a lot of his students who he did teach in the 101s go on to lots of the positions of influence. And they looked back and said, oh, I remember that oceanography class I took from Dr. Tarekian. And so I think one of the areas that just overall, just to engage more, that science is not a scary thing. It comes across as a scary and cold language. And yet, really, it is, Daryl, as you articulated, just the basic being of everything that we talk about. I always say, you know, nature is about the movement to stability. It's about the going from differences to try to think about ways to create balance. And that's true in sort of the thermodynamic system, but it's also true in the way that we think about politics. And so I've been, I just know, just from our standpoint, over the last, you know, 15 years, the numbers of PhD scientists and engineers in the State Department is actually close to 300. And the beauty of that is that whatever, are not just distributed in the traditional science-based parts of the department. It has been an explicit effort because of, I think, leadership at the very top giving positions for scientists to have flexibility to penetrate throughout the building and hopefully be value-added to the regional bureaus and to be value-added throughout the system. And I think that one of the great things that we've been able to do, again, because of support across administrations at the upper levels of management, has been to actually increase, albeit slowly, the numbers of positions and the flexibility of those positions to bring more scientists in. So you're not just bringing scientists in when there's a problem. It's that you're bringing them in to work there, to learn how the system works, and vice versa, that every scientist is not sitting there with a lab coat mixing green chemicals, blowing things up. And every diplomat is not sitting there becoming an alcoholic, sitting in the corner. We actually learn from each other very well, that we actually have the same sort of passions and interesting things. So yeah, no, it's been great, and I've enjoyed working with my colleagues across the department and actually throughout the community more broadly.
In terms of finding a way to bring the worlds of diplomats and scientists closer together and spend more time in the sweet spot on the Venn diagram, it struck me that from my 30 years experience of actually doing diplomacy, that too many diplomats seem to view the foreign ministry as a cathedral, the foreign service as a kind of a priesthood, and diplomacy as liturgy, which is to say that they were not particularly open to experimenting with new ways. And remember my quote from Einstein, you know, we're not going to solve these new problems with old ways of thinking. But there's an awful lot of old think in these institutions and a real need for ventilation. And I say, you know, turn the outside in, bring the inside out, and let some fresh air into these spaces. Like, for example, heads of mission or people entering executive positions in foreign ministries, I would make a precondition for either assignment abroad as head of mission or entering the executive cadre, demonstrated success at working outside of the foreign ministry, either in a university or a think tank or in private business or wherever, because too many people just drink too much Kool-Aid for too long, and it really affects their performance. Scientists, similarly, and this is... Since starting to research in this area, I've come upon this more frequently. I think they have to get over their insularity and fear of contamination, and they need to increase their awareness of not just global issues, but how they can contextualize the skills and experiences that they've developed and apply them to these larger challenges, because often scientists are just terribly focused on their particular research interest, and the sides have got to come off that. They need to embrace a larger public policy and political role, and there's a real resistance to that too. So we have some huge challenges. I mean, there's just no doubt about that, but you know, it really strikes me that the case is so strong that unless we can equip ourselves better than we are at the moment to up our game, to improve performance, and to deal more effectively with the challenges embedded in this new threat set, then our prospects are really not nearly as bright as we might wish them to be. And this is, I think it's kind of the sleeper issue of the day at the moment. And it's a hard one to talk about. I'm really trying to develop language and arguments and stuff that kind of make it more accessible, but I'm so glad that you folks came out, because even finding people that want to engage with the subject matter is a challenge some days. Yes.
One of my frustrations has been just, I think you just hit it on the nail. New world, huge challenges, interdisciplinary, complex, global, local, messy, wicked, whatever you want to say, right? And as I'm coming up to 55 years old, I'm looking at, you know, young people that are inheriting these challenges and recognizing that we need to do a better job of empowering and supporting them. And so what we've done is create a new NGO that's focused on bringing older people, younger people together in collaborative engagements. We're trying to incubate out of living room salons and bring multi-different perspectives together in informal, safe, neutral space with the Global CoLab Network, which we've established. And so I just throw that out as one example of an effort to try to change the culture. In DC, we have so many great resources, as we do in many cities, but particularly here, with young people, institutions, experts, all of it, but we tend to work in silos. And yes, we come together to collaborate in coalitions periodically, but we're really incentivized to compete and not to collaborate. And so to the extent that we can try to shift the way we operate in terms of how we look at challenges, whether they're big or small, local or global, and really try to convene in a different way, mm-hmm. And learn from design thinking and from mindfulness and, you know, a lot of this stuff, and bring in the science and the policy and the different sectors, and bring in and make sure we have, you know, millennials in our discussions helping us solve these problems so that we're not just older folks in the room is really what we're trying to do. So I'd be delighted to chat with anybody about that if they're interested.
Well, I guess we'll give it a wrap. Thank you all for coming.